buddy.
Hi.
Let me
Should
see
I roll here. Over?
Let me go online so that we can talk to people. Tonight.
Should I roll over?
What? Yeah, roll over.
Come You'll on over roll here. Over.
Come on over here. Wait a minute. Let me do a few things here just so I can feel better about this. It's the first person up is Jason tonight.
Hey.
Hello, Jason. How are
Hello.
You?
Hello.
What? Yeah, I'll share.
There we
it with
go.
You. Yeah, there you go. Hi,
Hi
Jason. How are you?
Pretty good yourself.
Yeah. Let's see. When your picture comes on, I'll diminish
is.
Us.
Okay.
And actually,
handsome
I'll do,
devil he is.
I'll do this
is
because.
Is that a cat stand behind you?
Yes.
Yes.
A scratching post.
And how many cats do you have?
I just have one.
Huh?
One.
You just have one?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm trying to do something here. Yeah. There we go. I'm trying to.
Is it just me or is there an echo?
No, there's no echo.
Okay.
You're fine.
No, he has an echo.
No, he doesn't have an echo.
He just said that.
But he doesn't have an echo.
As long as it's not on your end, that's good.
Jason joins us on Friday nights about every 2 weeks, right?
Yes, sir.
Because your wife won't let you call any more than that?
Yeah, I heard me get dogged out last week.
Huh?
I said, I heard me get called out last week.
Oh, yeah, you got called out by us, actually.
You should invite her on. That might open up the whole thing.
She used to come on once in a while, but, you know, talk radio is not her thing.
Yeah.
Not my thing either.
Well, this isn't exactly talk radio either. This is, oh, here comes Phil.
Hey.
Wait a minute, I added Phil, but then he went away.
There he is. No, call back, Phil.
No, Phil, you got to call back. Phil, oh well.
Oh well.
It's different when I'm talking to you on this Skype. You're my whole entire screen. Before, I think it used to just be you were a big picture on my screen, but right now you're the whole screen.
Wow.
Well, I'm the whole screen because I'm the only one talking right now.
Yeah, but I was saying, on Skype before, it used to just still be the Skype background, and it was just a one big picture.
Now we're the background picture.
Here comes Phil. Phil. Now let's see. There we go. Hello, Phil.
Hey, I tried calling, but when you didn't answer a few rings, I figured there might have been a problem since I couldn't listen to the live feed at the same time.
Well,
that's
why. Don't get anxious.
Well, you know, I don't want to have it making noise and you can't answer it.
Right.
Bump, bump.
Bump, bump.
Bump, bump, bump.
Anyway, people should call us tonight. It's TV night.
Lines are open.
Get your mug on TV.
Yeah.
I'm trying to fix some things here for people who are watching me move around here. There we go. Then I can see what's going on here. Anyway. So what's new, Jason? We haven't talked to you in a couple of weeks because
I was saying. So since I talked to you last, have you seen this?
What? What? Wait a minute.
I cut my hair off.
Turn around.
Remember, I used to have long hair.
Wow. Handsome devil, you.
I was growing it out to cut it off to donate it to this organization called Wigs for Kids.
So
I think they said that my hair was so nappy that some nice little Jewish girl somewhere was going to love it.
Is that like locks of love or something?
Yeah.
Yeah. And you had a ponytail, didn't you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Wow. I like it.
I used to have a ponytail.
Yeah.
And then I found out that I couldn't waste her hair that way. It was getting too precious.
Yeah. Your bald scalp was taking over.
Yeah. Yeah.
Was connected to a pony.
What?
Your ponytail.
Yeah. So we only get to talk to Jason once every 2 weeks because his wife would rather. I was going to say that, but then I decided against that.
Pussy whip.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's a nice lady, however, Sabrina. You know, she has a lot of power over you, doesn't she?
Of course, man.
Well, you know, somebody said that if your wife wants something, give it to her.
Give it to her.
Just don't even argue, you know.
It's cheaper than a divorce.
And if it's a fight, if you're having a fight, okay, it's my fault, all right? And guys are actually always willing to say it's their fault.
It's it was the same conversation where you guys were talking about when I come on. Is I think Phil mentioned that I got a new truck. No, mm-hmm. Phil, do you know who got a new truck?
Sabrina?
Yeah, she got a new truck.
You got to work on the deck in the backyard.
Yeah, I get to work on that this weekend.
She drives the truck.
Oh, so the truck is for her.
Yeah, nice $50,000 truck.
Wow.
$50,000 for a truck?
Oh, yeah. Wait a minute, pay top dollar for a made in, actually, that one was a made in Mexico truck. But
Does that truck by any chance blow you?
I wish.
Only the drive.
Have the little sleeper in it?
Listen, I've had cars that were the most expensive cars on that particular thing. Like I had an Acura that was top of the line, and it didn't cost $50,000.
Yeah, well, how long ago was that?
Well, that was about 40 years ago.
When he bought that, the Model T was just coming out.
Yeah.
And Ford said only $495. It's all it's going to cost you.
Every color, including black.
No, you can have any color as long as it's black. That was the line. Hi, Charlene.
Hi.
How are you this evening?
I'm okay. I've been enjoying, I've been listening to replays.
Yeah.
And I've been enjoying you, trying to inform Phil about,
it's a lost cause.
Yeah, like that documentary that you want him to watch on PBS. I want to watch that too.
I'm sure he hasn't gotten anywhere near it
yet. Which documentary?
Not yet, but
that's going to explain Al Qaeda to him, and
Alex, I actually work for a living and can't necessarily sit down and watch something on cue. But I had binge watched 14 episodes.
Yeah, you can do that.
Quantico.
Huh?
Quantico.
Oh, fuck you. Fuck you.
But
I've seen Quantico. That's the Indian girl.
Yeah.
It's in the FBI, and
found a new show, and Michael Snyder recommended it, and I had seen like a couple of minutes of it and didn't like it originally. Couldn't get into it. Actually, it was the wrong one. I was thinking of another one that I couldn't get into. So I decided to take a look at it tonight, and I'm going to get her to watch it because it's really funny.
What is it?
It's called You're the Worst.
My wife's watching that right now.
Does she like it?
Yeah, we've been watching it. I like it, but,
Well, the first episode, it's not, silly is not the way to describe it.
It's a little different, but, a little bit, it's American/British humor combination, I would say.
Yeah,
I love that.
But it's not done in Britain.
Yeah.
But the lead character is a Brit, the guy who's the worst.
You know what I love that we've been watching?
Right here, talking to the mic.
Sex, Drugs, and Rock and Roll. Have you seen that? It's great.
It's a Dennis Leary show.
It's fantastic.
Very good.
He plays an aging rocker, and his daughter is coming of age, and she's a great singer.
Yeah.
So he's kind of been put off into secondary, like helping her career.
Yeah.
It's very good. Very well done.
We've been binging Blue Bloods.
Really?
Yeah. It's a pretty good show.
Is it?
Yeah,
I've been watching that John Turturro thing that you talked about. What is it, The Night Of or something?
Yeah. Very good.
The last episode of Roadies was very good.
I like. Yeah, Roadies was a very good show.
The entertainers they had for Phil's funeral.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
But she said.
I watched a couple.
No, you watched one.
Couple.
And you decided. And I think it was in the first 10 minutes you decided you didn't like it.
I watched a couple.
No, you didn't watch a couple.
Alex, I watched her go off to do her film thing and then come back.
Okay. That was all the first episode.
It's like
the
second episode.
Well, second episode. So the
show got better and better and better.
Oh, absolutely. And the last one was vintage
Cameron Crowe. Because it was like almost famous. That kind of thing about following the rock band.
And these were the people and how they interacted, and you get to like them. I mean, they're great, and I even liked Phil. Of course, he was my namesake. But
which one was Phil?
Phil was the old roadie.
Serbic,
the old roadie that, and he was really, in some ways, the soul of the show.
Yeah.
But it's all about these roadies, and it's it's really just about the people. It's kind of a you know, a family drama, if you were, except a different kind of family. And I just found it really good. I mean, you know, the episode where Phil tells a story about him being with Lynyrd Skynyrd as their roadie, as their road manager, and how everybody has their own band, you know, that was their band, and his band was Lynyrd Skynyrd, and then they went off and bought the wrong airplane.
Yeah.
You know. But that's a great little show.
Yeah. Was that the last episode of the season?
Yeah. It may be the last one ever, because the ratings haven't been that good on.
Oh, that's unfortunate.
But we don't know. Showtime hasn't said yet whether they're going to renew it or not. How do you not renew a show that's produced by J.J. Abrams and Cameron Crowe? Yeah. You know,
they didn't renew Vinyl, and Vinyl was
now,
great.
That was the
they
one.
They didn't. Oh, yeah, I didn't hear that.
That was what was amazing.
So that's it, one season, and they're not going to do any more.
And it was great.
Here's what takes nerve. When you're at HBO and you've got a show that's produced by Martin Scorsese and Mick Jagger and you cancel it. You know, that takes nerve. Hi, Rob.
And it was good. It was
Hello.
A good production. Yeah. Hi, Rob.
How are you?
Yeah. I thought it was okay. I thought it deserved another year, and I figured, hey, you got Mick Jagger producing it and Martin Scorsese. Who says no to them?
I don't have HBO. What was the show called?
Vinyl.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, I like that show. What happened to it?
They canceled.
They canceled it.
Yeah.
I thought it would get better in the second season. Yeah.
I liked it in the first.
I liked
all
it.
That cocaine.
I mean, how do you call up Mick Jagger and tell him you're canceling his show?
And if someone
and what's
it,
his reaction? You're going to do what?
You can't always get what you want.
His son was in it.
His son was in it, yeah.
Can't get no satisfaction.
Right.
Yeah. How you doing? How you doing, Rob?
Good, good. Looking forward to this relaxing 3-day weekend.
Oh, yeah, this is, you see, it is a 3-day weekend. I know, I told everybody to take Monday off.
And I am. I'm taking Monday off.
Yeah, and since you're kind of part of our crew, Rob, take Monday off, will you?
Okay, sure.
Okay. And I just noticed you left something in the Dropbox. Thank you for that.
I finally remembered to do it. I saw your email, and I'm always, never up here that much anymore.
What I wanted to do is just change the background music on some of the images, just for the hell of it.
Right.
Or even have more. But have you noticed that the imaging music that you use for, let me see if I can find it here right off the bat. Hold on a second, folks. It takes me a second to get everything here. Wait a minute. Relax that. Okay. I think it's this one. I think it's this one. There.
This is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk radio like you've never heard it before.
Have you seen the commercial for Reese's Peanut Butter Cups?
No.
That's the music. That's only
well, they
the only
stole
music
it from me.
Yeah.
They had it playing all through the Olympics.
And the commercial is just like 15 seconds long, and it's just that music.
Well, it comes from audio blogs, and I guess you have video blogs?
No, audio blogs, and I have video blogs as well.
Yeah. And you're only paying $99 a year for both?
No, I'm paying $99, and they just raised the price to $149 a year for the video blogs.
You should go sign up for a community college class somewhere and get that one thing that Phil was talking about for $49, $19.99 a month.
That's right. And you could get all of
You could say that you're...
How did you prove that you were taking a course so that you could get Adobe cheap?
Didn't have to. But, you know, I could have said I'm going to the Bennett School of Broadcasting. And
no, wait a minute. But after 4 years, aren't they going to say to you, that's it?
I'll worry about it in 4 years. I'll just tell them I'm going to graduate school, the Bennett School of Broadcasting graduate class.
I got it for $29 initially.
Yeah. I had it for $29 initially also because I signed up right away.
Well, also because I had Final Cut Pro, and so I just said I had Final Cut Pro. I didn't even have to prove it.
But what I, no, and I didn't either. And what I did was about 6 months into it, I wasn't using anything else. So I reduced it to the photographer's one, which is $9.99, Lightroom and Photoshop.
Yeah.
But then I found that I wanted to use, what is it? Let me look at it. Adobe Audition.
Yeah.
And which I still don't know how to use, but I went to buy Adobe Audition and I couldn't buy it. And then I,
that's the reason why I buy the whole package is because I want the Adobe Audition, which you can't buy separately.
Yeah. Right. So, so what I did was I went online, I called the guy, I said, I want to upgrade. And, somebody told me about the student one. I looked into it. He told me how to get to it. And $19.99 a month later.
Write me and tell me how to get to the student part. I'll try and sign up for it and say I'm a student.
Hey, guys, I'm going to say goodnight.
Hey.
Good night.
Okay, everybody else you can call now. She's leaving the room.
She's the reason everybody called.
Anyway, so just send me the information on where I go, and I'll see if I can say that I'm a student.
Okay, it was very easy, and you know, I actually picked a community college that I used to go to, College of Marin.
Yeah.
And that was good enough.
Well, I went to College of Marin, so I'll say, I went to City College of San Francisco, I'll say that.
Yeah, I did too.
And all you had to say is what school you go to, and that was it?
That was it.
Son of a bitch. Well, you know, I do get my money. Even at $49 a month, I get my money's worth because I use Adobe Audition a lot, and I use Photoshop a lot, and I use Premiere a lot. You know, I use a lot of these things, but there are programs there you'll never, ever use.
You know, I just wanted Audition because I'm still fooling around with that thing. I just can't figure out how to get the file onto it. I have it on
drag and drop a file.
Yeah, but I have it on this kind of media, and then I put it in the reader and try to drag and drop it.
If you have the audio file, you just drag and drop the file into the window.
Maybe I just don't know how to make it.
Maybe you don't know how to drag and drop.
No, I know how to drag and drop. I don't know how to make it play. I can't figure out how to get the sound out of it.
Where does it come from? That little.
From a Zoom 6 recorder.
Was that an SD chip or SD card?
Yeah.
Do you have to download and actually store the file onto your device first?
Maybe that might be the thing. Just take the files and put them on your...
Shouldn't have to.
Huh?
You shouldn't have to. No.
It's just like a drive.
Yeah, you just play like right off the computer input.
I've always had a hard time with those SDs, man. Sometimes I plug it in and it'll open up automatically. Sometimes it won't.
Yeah. And, you know, SDs aren't that fast. I have a camera now that has something called an XQD, which is a Sony thing, and it's so much faster. But Nikon's the only one that's using it, and only in one camera.
And that's, so when you do that, you, as soon as it's not popular, it goes away, and then you're stuck.
Yeah, well, I have a...
How many media do you have sitting around your house that you don't even have the players for anymore?
I threw out most of that stuff.
You still have your zip drive. You still have your what was the big zip drive? Was the
iOmega?
No, the iOmega made zip drive.
And the Jazz.
Yeah, I still have Jazz cartridges. I don't have a Jazz machine.
I don't use to back up data at the store. That was my backup drive, and I don't need it anymore, and so I just threw it all away.
Yeah. Well, what we should do is one day we should, I should start a swap shop on the show for anybody who wants to call in and get rid of old media. I have a thing called DVD RAM that I don't have a player for. Can't find a player anywhere for it.
You know?
And it's got video on it.
You know, the thing that's funny that kids these days probably won't even understand this, but it was a saying when I was growing up. Never stick your floppy or hard in somebody else's slot.
good advice for all of us.
That's how you get a virus.
Yeah.
Yeah. We could use some callers. The reason things have been slow, I think, is because we're coming on this Labor Day weekend, and this is people's last chance to get out of town and do stuff. You're not going anywhere, right, Phil?
I'm going on a motorcycle ride Monday.
Yeah. Jason? That's
Point Reyes.
No, normally we would go up north, but school starts right on Tuesday, so I got to get my kid adjusted to, you know, going to bed early and waking up on time. If we were to go up north, he wouldn't be going to bed till like midnight. So.
Right. And how old's the kid now?
8.
He's just starting school or?
3rd grade.
3rd grade. I see. I don't know those things.
See, back in your day, you'd be graduating at 8 years old.
All the way from Hawaii, we're being joined by James Lee, but I can see that he's on an iPad tonight, so we're not going to see him. Right, James?
Negative, Mr. Ben. I'm calling you on the phone right now.
Oh, I see. Okay.
How's the hurricane?
All right. Just want to say, hopefully it's going to miss us heading north, coming in from east, but heading north. So I think it'll miss us maybe by about, 200, 300 miles. So we got some wind and heavy overcast and heavy misting going on right now. And the Wi-Fi is not doing very well out here. This is Lester. This is Lester. Madeline didn't do too much. We had heavy wind here, but no trees came down.
They
did shut the schools down and all that good stuff.
Was worried about you, including Renee, because she said because the place where you are on the island, you might get hit with it, but where she is, she wouldn't get hit with it.
We just keep reviewing our insurance policies.
Can you be insured for that sort of thing?
Pardon me?
Can you be insured for that sort of thing? Because in certain areas, like in San Francisco, it's almost impossible. I mean, the price is impossible if you want
hurricane insurance is available out here, but it's sort of a one-time deal. A lot of your continental United States insurers will not insure here in Hawaii because of, we're on the ring of fire here, volcanic, what have you.
Yeah.
So it's sort of a one-time deal. You hopefully you collect and then you just take the money and run because they'll never reinsure you again.
Oh boy.
Well, anyway, I just wanted to interrupt and you folks. I know you're talking about your other technical stuff over there, and just let you know that we're hanging in over here.
Yeah,
we'll be monitoring.
We're glad you called us because we were a little worried about you.
Yeah. All right, very good. Well, the citizen panel, everybody have a good aloha, and we'll hang in over here and batten the hatches down tight. You know, keep our head low and pull our rear end in real tight. We'll be good.
We'll keep a good thought out for you. Bye.
Yeah. Thanks. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Yeah, if you
what is this? There's a Hurricane Hermine or something. What's mine. That?
That's
I thought
Florida,
I heard that on the news. Oh, that's Florida?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So like how many different hurricanes are going on now?
Four.
Four different ones?
Well,
wow.
One of them was downgraded in Hawaii to a tropical storm.
There's two that are hitting Hawaii, one tropical storm now, but like right after each other.
In North Carolina, which one hit there?
Yeah, Renee, if you're out there, we'd love to hear from you and make sure you're okay.
That's going to be the Hermine or whatever the heck that's hitting Florida.
Is that male or female, Hermine?
Hermine is a female.
Oh, okay.
I thought that hurricane was called the Doug Dupree.
So let me. You want to get Phil going again tonight? You want to wind him up?
You got nothing else.
Get him going again.
What do you mean? I got nothing else.
Yeah, you're not going to pick on Jason. He doesn't call enough. Rob, you wouldn't pick on him. And Charlene.
There's a reason why I wouldn't pick on any.
He'll pick
those.
On her.
She's a girl.
No, but you're kind of like a guy walking around with a sign on his back that says "Kick me."
Oh, okay. I'm glad you like that.
Yeah, yeah. Here's what I wanted to bring up, it's the Stanford rapist.
Oh yeah, Brock.
His name is Turner. Brock Turner, and. In fact, Brock Turner Overdrive. No.
Did I send you that by mistake?
What?
Did I send you that by mistake this morning when I sent you the
no.
George Clooney thing?
No.
Oh.
No, but the George Clooney thing I saw. I saw before you ever sent it to me.
Oh, well, because...
It wasn't about George Clooney.
I know. It was
referring to people like George Clooney who live in the area, but he doesn't even live in Lake Como anymore. He moved to London.
Smart guy, huh?
Yeah. Well, I think he got tired of Lake Como. Yeah, too many Syrians. So the story was that Syrians had moved into, where was it, Switzerland?
Yeah, 500 of them were deported from Switzerland.
500 deported from Switzerland back to Italy where they came from, and they wound up in Lake Como, which is a big tourist area, and there are all these Syrians around the train station sleeping on benches and things like that.
Sidewalks.
Yeah. But anyway.
It's just a couple of train stops above Lake Como to where you get to Switzerland anyway.
Yeah. So anyway, Brock Turner, let's get to him for a second. This is a kid who, they found him having sex with a passed out woman in front of a dumpster in Stanford.
Yeah, at the Stanford University.
And they charged him with rape, and he was convicted, and the judge gave him 6 months, which made everybody get apoplectic. You know, got to go out there, we got to get this guy, we got to... make him suffer. 6 months isn't enough suffering. And then they were calling for this judge, who's Aaron Persky,
to resign,
or they wanted to impeach him, or to not, you know. Anyway, today, it turns out that if you got a 6 month term in jail, if you got good behavior, you get out in 90 days.
Great. Yeah.
And so today they let him go. And of course, everybody got really apoplectic again. You know, all of a sudden there was this visceral response, and off we go once again into the breach, dear friends, with people yelling and screaming and wanting this Persky's bench, so to speak.
You don't think this Brock Turner was just an opportunistic, stupid idiot that took advantage of a situation and is not really a rapist?
That's a rapist, Phil.
If somebody is having sex with you, and if they're passed out, let's say, and you're having sex with them, that's rape, because there's no way they can say, okay, let's have sex.
Well, you know, if I woke up and my old lady was going down on me.
It's your old lady.
Hey, you know, Phil, if you woke up and my dick was in your ass, how would you feel about that?
Well, it's so small,
Jason, and I hope you have a chance to do it someday.
But if I was with a woman and I was asleep and she was pleasuring herself and myself, I'd just say, oh, okay, great, I'm awake now. Let's even if I
from that point of view, first of all, second of all, it's the woman it's sleeping in your bed, as opposed to somebody by a dumpster.
That's out next to the dumpster.
Well, and like I said, I honestly, Phil, that'd be a better comparison. You woke up and my dick is in your ass.
Right. That's true.
You got to look at it at that point of view. Not that it's your girlfriend or it's some stranger, some hot chick who she's giving you a blowjob while you're passed out. Hey, that's awesome. That's great. I'd love that too. But, I wake up, some dude's dick is in my ass. I want to fucking kill the person,
Yeah. All I'm saying is that, this was rape.
Unless it was like her boyfriend and she was kind of consensual, because she would have let him do it anyway, and it was basically a public...
I contend that even a boyfriend can rape his girlfriend.
Yeah.
And quite frankly, a girlfriend can rape her boyfriend. I maintain that, because I had somebody I had somebody do that to me.
Yeah. I just the guy who up gave with my you girlfriend. A blowjob.
I didn't want to have... this woman I knew came over... She didn't want to drive all the way back to San Jose. And I said, fine, you can stay here. And, you don't have to sleep on the couch. That's ridiculous. You can sleep in the bed. But I don't want to have any sex because I'm too depressed over my girlfriend being gone. I wake up in the middle of the night. She's blowing me. And I asked her to stop. But she didn't stop. And then she hopped up on top of me. And I felt horrible. I felt terrible. I felt raped.
You were so used.
Well, no, you know something, Phil? That's a shitty kind of attitude to have, because the idea is, a guy can't get raped. Guy wants it all the time. Not all the time.
Typically, though.
And not that night. And I said as much,
See, I would have thought you would have said the time that you found out a guy was giving you a blowjob.
No, that I kept him doing it because I wanted to see what it was like. And except for the stubble, he was doing a pretty good job.
He got chafed.
Huh? He put his back in afterwards?
What?
Did he put his teeth back in there?
No, he had teeth. He had teeth. No, you've heard the story before. I was at a
group accidental blowjob.
A group sex thing, and I'm suddenly being pleasured, and I look down, and it's a guy doing it. And I figured, what the fuck? I'm never, I need the experience. Let's see more, what this is like. What?
Do you get, was it one of those things where you go, I can make a scene here, or just fuck it?
No, I actually said to myself, because I was always into experiencing stuff, and I said, this is something that I've never experienced before, so let me see if I enjoy it or not. And the fact was, he was doing a pretty good job, but as I say, the stubble was bothering me. It wasn't a female mouth, okay? And
is that story in Life in the Passing Lane?
No, I never told that story in Life in the Passing Lane. No.
You should add an addendum there.
Well, maybe I'll tell a whole bunch of other stories later on. But
America
anyway,
already knows.
The point was, it was an enlightening moment for me, I was watching Seinfeld the other day. And it was the episode where Elaine is trying to get this gay guy to sleep with her and finally gets him to sleep with her. And then he goes back to guys. And she says to Jerry, why? Why does he go back to guys after being with me? And he says, they've had that equipment all their life. And someone else who knows that equipment like they do can certainly do a better job of it. And I think there's some truth in that,
Yeah, but there's the problem with it is, and I could imagine that a guy would do a better job and a woman would do a better job on a woman, but there's no excitement over the fact that it's a guy doing it. It's like, that's the problem. The problem
is the guys that want it.
Meaning, I don't want to look at a guy,
Well, no, the only thing that would turn you off, let me put it this way, a mouth is a mouth. Okay?
Well,
and the only thing as a guy that would turn you off was your fear of, am I being gay? If you realize you're not being gay, you're just getting blown.
Well, a lot of people will say a blowjob makes you gay.
Well, then I guess any woman who's ever given me a blowjob has made me gay. I don't know.
Because
that's not the same thing.
What do you mean it's not the same thing? I mean, a blowjob is a blowjob.
Well, I guess you should clarify.
It's either a good blowjob or it's a bad blowjob.
Okay. Any kind of sexual.
Excuse me, Charlene. You can join in anytime you want to.
About blowjobs, okay.
You just walk up to the glory hole, stick it in, and whoever drops to the knees is good enough?
If you don't know what's on the other side of that glory hole, it doesn't really matter, does it? It either feels good or it doesn't feel good. Huh?
I never went to a glory hole.
I never went to a glory hole either.
I can't imagine. I can't imagine wanting to do that though.
I had an employee.
My thought would be, who the hell is over there?
Yeah.
And why do I want them doing that to me?
In the 70s, I had this gay employee, and he was always going to the baths, and he would tell me about the glory hole and this, that, and the other thing. And he was an unusual guy.
Well, I mean, let me say this about guys. Guys have sex differently than women do. There's a whole different mental process going on. Guys can be completely detached from the person, and simply be living for the pleasure. Where women have to have some kind of emotional attachment to the person that they're doing. Am I right, Charlene? Am I making sense here? And part of that is born out of the fact that the end product of sex for a
penetrator,
lot of women,
penetratee.
Penetration is a different factor than being a penetratee. It's a very good point. But more than that, women are very self-protective of themselves because they can get pregnant. They can have children as a result of this, where guys can have children and then run out of town. So women, just out of pure protection, are a little more careful about who they sleep with, okay? Mm-hmm. They have to be attracted to them. Guys?
That's true.
How many women have you had sex with in your lifetime you weren't attracted to?
A few.
I could name more than a few in my case, if Rob, would you go along with
that? I agree with that, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we can...
God forbid I would get pregnant from Phil... and have a baby, and it would have all misinformation and be into
how
the.
How you did it was Donald Trump.
What's his new group now? The John Birch Society. Sometimes Phil loves too much.
To champion anti-Semitic groups.
Yeah. Well, they don't sound too anti-Semitic on their website.
Well, they are known as being incredible anti-Semites.
Okay? Well, they say that about Donald Trump, and he's not an anti-Semite.
I didn't say you said it.
I said they
I've
say
never
it.
Felt that Donald Trump has said anything bad about Jews.
No.
He doesn't dare.
My son-in-law is a Jew.
Not if he wants to get anything more built in this town. He doesn't go after Italians either.
No. You know, he actually doesn't go after anybody. He wasn't even going after the Mexicans.
Ah, bullshit. They all come over here. They're drug smugglers. They got calves the size of...
Rapists. They're rapists.
Did you hear the line that one of his Mexican panel, you know, one of the backers of Trump, one of the Trump supporters?
I didn't hear the line.
The line was... you let Hillary do what she's going to do or whatever. Let them do whatever they're going to do. There's going to be a taco truck on every corner. And that was from a Mexican guy.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's what they want. They want a path to citizenship, which is basically amnesty.
Wait a minute. Refresh my memory. This is America, right?
Right.
Jimmy, you're tired. You're
No. French gave us.
They sent us a statute.
It was a statue,
on, and we went along with it. Okay.
Yeah.
We accepted it. I would really, you know, like to know why somebody shouldn't be given a path to citizenship. That was the promise of America.
They didn't come here legally. They didn't emigrate. They didn't get in line like the people.
A lot of people came into this country and didn't come in legally, okay? And they were Jews during World War II.
No, I think they went through Ellis Island.
No, they didn't. Do you know when Ellis Island closed?
1921 or something?
Yeah, well, World War II wasn't 1921.
Well, look, there was...
So how could you go through it if it was closed?
Wait, Jason has his hand up. A very big hand, I might add.
Hey, and this is coming from a Mexican who is a descendant of an illegal alien. Yeah. You know, back in the day, you know, Ellis Island, you just showed up, you signed your name on a piece of paper, you were let in.
Oh.
So, if they were to do that again, hey, everybody who is an illegal, they'll sign their name on the piece of paper, say they're legal.
Why not do that?
There's jobs that are offered that other people don't want to do. You know, why not tell these people, hey, you know what, you're welcome in here to do these jobs. Instead, we'll sit there and say, you're not welcome in, but if you're a doctor or a lawyer or somebody who's going to take an actual job away from an American, we'll let you in.
I have a question for you, Jason. Does the math there really work? Because a lot of the jobs that these guys take, the reason why they take them is because they don't pay they don't pay anything, right? So
it doesn't pay anything is because they are willing to take them.
Society won't pay much for these jobs anymore. Society won't pay much for somebody to pick oranges. Society won't pay much for somebody to pick strawberries or even lay concrete. Americans are too lazy to do these jobs.
Right, but if you're going to go and make them all legal jobs, and this is just a thought, right? If you're going to go and make them all legal jobs, that means you're going to tax that money, going to pay Social Security.
They already are. If you're an illegal, you're still paying taxes, you're still paying Social Security, you're just not collecting it because you're paying it under somebody else's Social Security number.
I
had to do a certified payroll today for a government job that I did. There was 72 pages of things that I had to fill out in order to get a check for $4,500. I was almost ready to let the check go rather than fill out these 72 pages. You wouldn't believe how much paperwork is involved to do this. It was a job I did for Habitat for Humanity, and they require a certified payroll. And you know what? I had to show that I paid $63.17 an hour to this guy in order to get paid.
What's the point you're trying to make?
Well, what I'm trying to say is that there are jobs out there, and you pay what it takes. If you have to pay $20 an hour for somebody to pick oranges because that's what it costs, then you charge appropriately for the oranges that were picked.
So you go to the store and you want to get a glass of orange juice and you're going to spend, you know, $30, $50 for one glass of orange juice.
Well, you know, everything is relative. And but you have to.
Society has demands.
Yes, but the society.
You know, but that's the whole thing too, though, Phil. I know that you're not a union person and you don't have union beliefs. But I think that with immigration, that's the perfect example too. Bring these people in who are willing to do the grunt work and make less money and you live a lower lifestyle. But they sit there and they want to live, you know, better themselves than what they have. So therefore, their children can get a little bit of better education. Their children can have a little bit of a better job. And then their children's children can do even better than they did.
They're sending the money back to Mexico untaxed.
Because they can't bring their whole family with them.
To begin with, it has been taxed. You're wrong. Charlene?
I like what Alex said the other day, that it's not that they want to come here. They have to come here, and that what we should do is try to work on that country to stop being such an oligarchy that, you know, the rich are running it and the poor are, you know.
Are suffering.
Yeah.
Go to the JohnBirchSociety.org, and you'll see about that. But
let's stop sending money to Israel so they can have all of their militarized shit over there, and let's start looking into our own backyard and maybe helping these governments, you know, in North America or South America, help them develop their government to be more self-sufficient.
If we didn't help Israel, we would have the Saudis and the
You shut up about Israel. You know why I'm telling you to shut up about Israel?
What's
because as long as you're spouting the John Birch Society, one of the most anti-Semitic groups that ever hit this country, don't sit around and tell me how you're supporting Israel.
I don't see how you prove that they're anti-Semitic.
Go back and look at their history and the kind of things that they published.
I've read stuff that they published for the last 25 years. It's on their website.
There was one book that they were promoting like crazy, the Elders of Protocols of the Elders of Zion.
Yeah.
It was a very big text for them. One of the most anti-Semitic books you'll ever read.
Okay.
So don't tell me about how you support Israel and all of that, and then you're flouting this anti-Semitic organization.
That's one of the other things too, Phil, that I've always meant to ask you, because you've sat there and you've talked about people who, you know, you say how they were a terrorist back in the past. Wasn't your BB, didn't he attack Americans?
Well, let me tell you something. The book that you just described was published in 1903.
Yes, and it was redistributed and given out by the John Birch Society in, I think, the 50s.
Purporting to describe the Jewish plan for global domination.
Yes.
I think it was probably a hate book, but I don't
see. I know about that book. You didn't know about that book.
But
I
don't see anything
here. I also know that the John Birch Society was using it as one of the texts that they would have people read back then. And don't argue with me, Phil, because you don't know what you're talking about.
No, I'm looking here. Not one thing has anything to do with John Birch.
The book itself does not have anything to do with the John Birch Society. It's that the John Birch Society was running around passing this book out.
All right. Let me look a little further.
Go to Wikipedia. Wikipedia is right about everything, including my biography, okay, where they had it all wrong. Boy. But anyway, getting back, how do we get from the rapist to this?
We've
lost Phil for the rest of the hour because he's going to have to somehow prove himself right, but he doesn't know the facts. Why don't you wait till the show's over with and look up the facts, okay? By the way, we're being joined by Renee, who is also in Hawaii. How's the storm doing with you, Renee?
Oh, we're fine over here. Thank you.
Okay. Want to make sure you're okay. Anyway.
Well, thank you. Have we heard from Jim yet?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, good, because he got his ass kicked over there.
He said no.
No, he said no. He said it missed him.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Missed.
So he got some mist, he got some wind, and that was it.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Excellent.
It missed him.
it misted him.
Anyway, let's get back to this kid. Okay.
What is that? Weather humor?
Yes.
We're talking about your friend Brock Turner.
Brock Turner.
The Stanford rapist. And trust me, every time you say his name and hashtag the word Stanford racist, Stanford University does not like it.
Stanford rapist? No, they want it to be Stanford swimmer.
Yeah. So hashtag Stanford rapist all you want.
Yeah.
All weekend long. Piss off Stanford University.
But here's the question. Everybody's calling for the job of the judge, and I think that's wrong. And I'm going to tell you why it's wrong, folks. It's wrong because you cannot intimidate judges to make a decision based upon the public wanting their head. You know, it ruined the judicial system if we allowed that to happen. Secondly, he made his decision based upon a recommendation from the parole board as to what the appropriate penalty would be.
Was there another rape that was conducted in the last couple of months that the guy got a similar sentence?
That I don't know.
Across the country? I think there was.
The kid for the rest of his life is going to have to register as a sex offender. I'd say that's a fairly significant penalty.
Right, because the women having to remember that they've been raped by a man and have to recalculate their brains every time they think they want to have sex or they kind of like this guy. But there's Brock Turner and all the rest of the rapists. So, yeah, it's tough being listed as a sex offender. It sucks.
Well, in at least the good part about this story was the woman was passed out and doesn't have to remember this incident.
I think she does remember. I think she said that she was having emotional issues over the...
probably after the fact, but I'm saying when it was happening, she was supposedly passed out, and some guys came upon him doing this and saw she was passed out and pulled him off of her.
Yeah.
Yeah, so she was pretty much passed out through the whole event. But I don't think you should go after the judge. I mean, he had to work under certain guidelines that he's given. And those guidelines...
I don't know, man. That's...
We didn't open our mouths until after he made his decision.
His decision was made...
Before we were allowed to...
But he didn't make it on his own. He was taking the recommendations of the parole boards. And
other people that wrote letters in behalf of Brock Turner.
No, but the main reason he gave him that specific sentence is that is what he was told by the parole people to give
him. Shit rolls uphill.
No, but judges have to go along with that.
They don't have to. They're the ultimate judge. That's why they're called the judge.
Lawyers saying, yes, he has to.
The deal is that this kind of behavior seemed to have been and has been pervasive on university campuses across the country and has been that way for a long time. And, until the student body changes their attitude.
No. This is a whole different thing.
Look at Berkeley. Cal Berkeley was raped all the time. My ex-wife got raped when she was...
Anytime you have young men and young women in the same area, you are going to have rapes, okay? It's going to happen. It shouldn't happen, but it does happen.
What's the matter with you raising children to think... I never got into this...
That's not what I'm saying, Renee. What I'm saying is... This is a brew which creates this kind of thing. And what you have to do is you have to have in place stopgaps to prevent it from happening.
Okay? Legal prostitution.
Huh?
Legal prostitution.
Legal prostitution.
I don't think that's it. People rape because of power, not because of need.
I don't think this kid was actually, if you want my opinion.
Yeah, I think he was just horny. He saw an opportunity.
I don't think this was an aggressive rape. I mean... Rape in generally is a hostile act, and it is a violent act. It is battery, okay? But in this case, she was passed out, and he's some stupid kid who wants to get laid, and he decides, oh, well, she's passed out. I may as well take advantage of that.
Opportunistic.
Did she know him before?
In the end, it is the definition of what he did is rape.
Yeah.
But it's not violent rape.
Did she know him before?
What?
Did she know him before he raped her? Friends?
That's what I was going to ask. Was it like a date rape or something?
I think he actually found her passed out by the dumpster.
And just started raping her.
Yeah.
But still, at the same question, though, Phil, I kind of know you. if you're passed out from drinking and you wake up with my dick in your ass, does that make it any better?
Maybe.
But if he doesn't wake up at all, that's the big question.
Thank you, Jason.
By the way, who have we been joined by? Is this...
It's Ted in San Francisco again.
Hi,
on
Ted.
The phone.
How do you feel about that Brock Turner situation?
Well, I did read about it, and he had been stalking her at a party.
Had he?
A musical party. He had been giving off bad vibes to her and her friend that she had gone with. So, and then she didn't remember anything after that.
Yeah.
So I wondered if she wasn't slipped some GHB, and then, because passing out, remembering anything, I mean, doesn't that fall into you got a serious alcohol? I mean, that
they probably would have tested for that, and that would have been part of the story too, though.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, who's the black comedian that she dated five? You know, just before she went to the party, slipped it a roofie.
Black?
Why is it a black guy that slipped?
Is he making a joke?
He's making a joke.
Turner
that
slipped. The 80-something-year-old comedian.
Bill Cosby?
Bill Cosby.
Didn't see it coming in. Good job, Turner.
Yeah. You know, it's just, I guess that's what Bill Cosby's being accused of. And
I'm going to say that rape in and of itself, normal rape, you grab a woman, you forcibly rape her, is battery. It's violent. It is
it's like mugged.
Whatever. The kind of thing that Cosby did is not your traditional rape, okay?
Wait a minute.
It's not your traditional rape in that he wasn't tying her down or holding her down and forcibly raping her. She's so out of it that she consents, you know.
What A said, that's why I thought that it was some similarity between the two.
You have to drug a woman or make her or get her drunk to have sex with you, I'm guessing she doesn't want anything to do with
it. Well, I can't tell you how many women I know that I went to bed with that wanted me to get them high and stoned so they could stand having sex with me. So, you know.
Know your place. You know?
Yeah. No,
that's the way it works,
then. I can't tell you the number of women that I've known over the years who've said, hey, do you have any drugs around? You have some coke? Great, let's do some coke and let's fuck. Okay, somebody could very easily have said, I gave her drugs to get her high.
The new one of, you know, of modern day is E. You know, a lot of girls take E, then have sex.
Yeah,
you know?
E's wonderful. See? I've given women Quaaludes because they asked for them. It could be argued that I gave her a Quaalude so I could have sex with her. Oh, I just raped her. No, I didn't. She asked for the goddamn Quaalude.
Usually, yeah.
But I don't have any proof that she asked.
He said, she said, though. So
yeah, it's he said, she said.
Did she ask to be raped when she was asking for Quaaludes?
No. But what I'm
she
saying,
has to have
I'm
sex.
Saying, in the case
let's
of
have
Quaaludes
Cosby, and then have sex.
I would say in a lot of the cases of Cosby, these were women who didn't mind at the time getting high. Okay, I'm not saying all of them. I'm saying some of them he roofied and had his way with them anyway.
But if it was a Quaalude, you don't lose your sense of reality anything else on a Quaalude. I mean, you're totally aware.
Who's had a Quaalude on this panel?
I have.
Anybody else?
I have for my time.
Okay, we got a 707 that has. And what was your 707, what's your experience with a Quaalude?
Total lucidity. I never pass out or anything like that. If that's what you mean.
But you really wanted to have sex, right?
Yeah.
Could you have done something against your own will? Something that you might not have done.
No.
Before you took the Quaalude.
Asking him, not you, Phil.
No. I'm asking.
You have the same desires as it's just that you probably are not quite as discriminatory.
Your inhibitions are lessened.
Mm-hmm. Well,
definitely. And that's why girls used to give them to girls because they brought out their basic instincts, you know, and the natural drive.
And ecstasy is another drug that ecstasy really gets you horny.
Never had that.
Oh, it's a wonderful drug.
You tried it?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and I would continue to try it. I've heard doctors say that there's nothing wrong, really, with ecstasy.
What kind of drug is it?
MDA
back in the day. There was MDA and an NMDA.
Yeah, but then there was ecstasy. And ecstasy is like everything feels good.
The problem is with ecstasy
the
rug. Right now is
I love touching the rug, you know.
You don't get the quality if you're getting the street stuff is what I'm hearing from online.
It's man-made.
Yeah, it's the man-made stuff that's just shit. And it's causing... Matter of fact, there was a problem.
Supposedly man-made ecstasy wasn't that bad. That was the thing. It was a drug without much consequence.
Isn't that why they make you have to go to the pharmacy counter to get some of these antihistamines or whatever.
That was because
crack.
And speed.
No,
it was the speed in that, and it was something that was being made into. It wasn't being made into ecstasy.
Yeah, now, it was being made into crack.
This is a natural ecstasy. If there's man-made,
natural ecstasy is somebody who had has some herbs he wanted to sell.
It's the decongestants that they use you have to go to the pharmacy counter because they use those to make E.
It's not E.
It's
methamphetamine.
Yeah, it's the ugly stuff. It's not ecstasy that they use.
It was used to make meth. Yeah.
They take the
Bill Clinton used to be hooked on Sudafed. You ever hear that story?
No.
Yeah, back when he was running for president in 92, Sudafed was like, he ate it like candy. And, you know, that's what they make meth from, you know, when they do, you know, synthesize it.
Dextromethorphan?
What were you saying, Renee?
I think it's called dextromethorphan, is the drug that they try to take out of the antihistamines to make meth. And
ecstasy
was everything I ever read or heard about ecstasy from doctors and everybody else. They said it was a totally benign drug. It just simply made you very, shall we say, sensitive to the atmosphere around you. You know, you love touching somebody's face. I mean, I've done it, and it was wonderful, a wonderful drug to have sex on.
How long has he been around?
I had a girlfriend
talking about
who liked me to take E with her to have sex. Again, she wanted to drug herself so she could stand having sex with me. And
she paid Marjorie.
She would come over with the E, and we would do the E. And you know, there was no way I wasn't going to have sex with her, and it wasn't going to be great sex.
So, when was that though? Is that in the 90s or?
Yeah.
Late 90s. Yeah, late
90s. Yeah, because they started calling it E around then. Before it was something else. It was called something else.
Yeah.
But let's talk about
Spanish Fly.
Spanish Fly. Let's talk about Brock Turner's parents and what a dick Brock Turner's dad is. That man started up a savings account and started a GoFundMe page.
Yeah, I love that. Wow. People start a GoFundMe page for something like that. Yeah. Anyway, go ahead.
People can help pay for the defense of the rapist Brock Turner. That's what his dad did.
See, but that's the only one thing. I agree with you 100% on everything about this guy, Renee, but, you know, I don't care what my kid did. I would try to help him.
You would try to help him, yeah.
Like, you know,
and everybody deserves
it. Doesn't make him a bad father.
Sure, that's what the courts are for.
It doesn't make him a bad father. What makes him a bad father is because Brock Turner turned out the way he did.
Yes, yes.
Okay, but saying that I'm going to do a GoFundMe because you want the best legal help you can get for your son. I was watching TMZ today, and they were talking about this case. And the guy who is the host of the show is also a lawyer.
Harvey Levin.
He was the one that was saying that the judge had no real say-so in how much the sentence should be. It was up to the people who recommend the sentencing, and he has to go with those guidelines.
Yeah, there's sentencing guidelines, but I don't know what they are.
Yeah, yeah. And he said that he said that we live in a society where if you've got enough money, you can win the case.
How much can you afford?
Yeah. I mean, he said, because you're going to need the lawyers and you're going to need the investigators. You're going to need a whole team of people to get you off of something. And that's why poor people go to jail and rich people don't.
Look at OJ.
And he said, we have to create a world in which that doesn't exist. OJ's a very good example of that.
I would say OJ woke a lot of this country up to that fact.
Oh, yeah, I agree.
Yeah, but you know, half the black people in this country looked upon that and said, well, it's about time one of ours got away with it because he had the money.
Well, true. You know?
But I think Rob is right. I don't think the United States understood the fact that if you have money, and this is predominantly a white issue at that point. I mean, and then when O.J. Simpson came in with his team and all of his money, everybody's like, oh, shit, it's not the criminal. It's not the court. It's all the money that you can throw at this whole thing and get off. So I thought it was pretty enlightening that people got to see, why go to jail? Just have a shitload of money. You don't need to go to jail.
If Alex didn't have $10,000 to throw at his case, he'd be looking for another apartment.
If we didn't have a, an equity loan on her other apartment.
Right. But still, if you couldn't lay your hands on that 10 grand, you would have been looking for an apartment.
If we didn't have the money.
Right.
We would probably be in another apartment right now.
Right.
You know, I mean, but we did. We were able to lay our hands on the money. And we do have the money. It's just we decided to borrow it rather than to, because eventually we're going to get our money back.
Yeah. Hope that.
Well, we hope that. And there's a good, very, very good chance of that. You know,
nobody's got loans out at a flexible interest rate, do they? Everybody's tightened up their loans.
I really don't know. All I know, and I also know that the girlfriend's apartment has raised in value amazingly.
Excellent. Actually. That's great.
Amazingly.
So you're like Trump. You're a New York real estate magnate.
That's correct. But the point is, Rob's absolutely right. If we didn't have the money, we'd be out on the street. Jason. Oh, Jason, turn on your microphone.
Were you talking about the home equity line of credit for other apartment?
Yeah.
Any other adjustable rate in interest?
Say be careful on that because I don't think that's a legal loan.
No. Yes, it is.
It's not your primary resident.
Huh?
It's not your primary residence.
No. She has a loan against her apartment.
It's called a HELOC, and it's just a second.
I know when I had equity loan on my old house, when I moved out and I asked my bank if I could transfer it over to the house I'm currently living in, they said, no, and you got to pay it off because that's not your primary residence.
Well, that's...
You sell the old house?
Believe me, everything's...
No, it's a rental.
Everything's fine with this, you know. It's a loan against that she can take from at any time that's against the worth of her apartment. It's part of the...
You know, Jason, what you have might be unique to Michigan, and you know, because I've never heard of not being able to have.
When I pulled the loan, it was my primary residence. Yeah. So then, after I moved out, and I still own the property, it was a rental. They said it was basically an illegal loan.
Phil knows of these kinds of loans, and they're fine, right, Phil?
Yeah, I've never had a problem. If I sold the property, then I had to pay off that second.
Exactly.
Right. This was straight from the bank, and I said, well, really, what can you do? if I'm paying on it.
For 9 on your application, which meant Mexican, and get money back.
What we're talking about equity loans, Rob?
Excuse me?
You know what we're talking about when we're talking about equity loans?
Sure.
Yeah.
Why?
Yeah. And you can use that. You don't have to live at your home in order to have that equity loan. You just have to own that house.
No. I don't think
state.
I think you have to. It has to be your primary residence, right?
That's what he's saying. But
well, could I say something about that?
Yeah, sure, Ted.
I happen to agree with Jason on that. I took out a home equity loan on my house in San Francisco back in '94. And I used that money to, what I did was that was something different. What I did is I was living in San Francisco, and I went to Bank of America, got a loan to buy a house in Sonoma. Mm-hmm. And they said, okay, you've got to show proof that you're going to be renting out your house in San Francisco, that it will no longer be your primary residence. And so I showed them the ad from the Chronicle, and that was good enough. However, I immediately, I didn't rent it out for many years, and eventually moved back there, mm-hmm. where I am now, and, you know, they never caught it. But in Jason's case, they did catch it for some
reason. Did you have a homeowner's equity line of credit on top of the mortgage?
No, not...
Well, that's what we're talking about.
Yeah, exactly. You're talking about that. I'm talking, but they did say
this is like a loan, and it is simply
it's a second mortgage.
It's a second mortgage. Yeah.
And it's against the equity in the house.
And you don't have to live there to get a second mortgage.
It's cheaper money than having to put everything on a credit card. If you know
exactly.
Like I said, that's just when the bank, because I called them to ask them about transferring that. You know, instead of using that house as collateral, using the house that I bought as collateral, they said, no, you can't do that. And since that's not your primary residence, like I said, that's why I asked him. I said, well, what can you do? You really can't do anything. I'm paying it, you know. But I just, luckily, I got a tax return, just paid it off anyway. So,
yeah.
It's not like a reverse mortgage, right? That's something different.
That's
right?
Something else.
It's because it's an investment property, and you're not supposed to be able to pull equity out of an investment property.
Right. It's just equity that you, if you have a mortgage for $50,000 and your house is $100,000, you got $50,000 worth of equity, and you need to borrow money, you could do that, and the interest on that loan is also tax deductible, unlike your credit cards. So people take home equity lines of credit.
Right. But you don't have to live in the home. Because she
did maybe originally, you know, because if you're there for 2 years,
and it may be a state law too,
yeah,
they may be state regulated those laws.
Yeah,
I would just be about it.
Well, they can't call the loan. It's not like he's paying another mortgage somewhere.
If it's somewhere in the contract that she signed when she got the loan agreement, you know, that's.
But when you got your loan agreement, you went to a place that had three gold balls out in front of it that said pawn, hardcore pawn. That's where you went.
Stop making fun of the only Hispanic on our panel, please.
Well, what's that show in Detroit?
Detroit, yeah. Yeah, hardcore pawn. I know what you're talking about. I think I've driven past it, but no.
You didn't go and see Les?
Just because I'm brown, I go to pawn stores?
No, I just go there. I live there. I love that place.
Yeah.
It's so fake. You know, all of those shows are so fake. You know, I don't know.
They sign a release before they get beat up.
But she used this home equity loan, among other things, to improve the apartment itself.
Yeah. Well, with today's interest rates, she could combine it into a first mortgage and amortize it over 30 years if she wanted to. This, you know, you can take that.
Yeah.
I don't know what her first is, but the rates are so low right now.
How low are they?
Well, they're like 3 3/8 or.
Borrowing money after the election is going to be way different than trying to borrow money right now.
See, that's what I got to look into, see if I can refinance my rental property. But because it's a rental property, they get a higher interest rate. And some banks don't even want to give you a loan on a rental property.
Yeah, wow. That's true. I didn't think about that. Yeah, because it's a lot lower if it's your primary residence.
And which really sucks. When I got the loan, it was awesome. But now it really sucks. 6%.
Oh, you'd be much better off trying to consolidate and turn it into a rental loan.
Before November, I would highly suggest you do it before the election's over.
Yeah, you might just be paying a point above prime or something if, you know, depending on your credit and everything.
But it's a rental, so I don't know if, be a lot, it's usually a lot higher. When I bought my house that I'm in now, it was considered an investment property and I still had to pay like a 5% interest rate on it. But then as soon as I moved into it, I could wait 6 months and refinance and got it down to, you know, a 3.5.
Yeah, well, what I'm suggesting is you go to like one of those things like LendingTree or something, put your information in and see what they'll give you.
You know, you got to be careful with those places.
I have one right here. Can you see? It's one of those things like LendingTree.
Quicken should be a fair. You could probably go to Quicken online and fill out some stuff and not.
Go online. I can walk over there.
Yeah. Quicken.
Detroit company.
They probably have a very good online GUI front end, and you'd probably find out a lot of information.
I tried to, but they have their thing right now. It's called the Rocket Mortgage, and it says it's all online. It's so quick and easy, and I was online for a half an hour trying to fill out crap.
Did they have it in Spanish?
Okay.
So anyway,
hey, Alex.
Yeah.
Alex, the reason I really called in, you were talking about the immigration, and Jason was saying how you know, they come over here, no one else will take the jobs, right? And so I was just calling in to support Phil on that. When I was a boy, I lived in Oklahoma. My dad had a farm, and one year he hired he had to put a fence around the land, so he hired five young black men. Okay. They were 25 cents an hour at the time. That's what they paid.
Yeah.
And these guys were the happiest guys you could find. I mean, they just seemed to be really enjoying what they were doing, okay? And then another year he did it, and he hired five Mexicans, okay? And, you know, they did a good job as well. And so what I'm saying is that I think the black people here have lost the work ethic because the Mexicans have moved in and taken those jobs. I mean, is there a possibility of that, Jason?
That doesn't sound racist at all.
No.
I'll tell you, the guy who put the fence up in my yard, he was a white guy, and you know, he made more than 25 cents an hour. But
well, I'm talking about 1963, okay?
But, and I understand, you know, the guy who I hired a company, and he actually hired a contractor, which I was a little disappointed because I would have rather hired that contractor directly. But, you know, putting in a fence is still somewhat of a skilled trade. You know, there's certain skilled trades that, you know, are more of necessities but are still lower paying jobs that just people won't take for what Americans are willing to pay for them. But yet, if you get an immigrant into this country, doesn't matter if they're Mexican or maybe, you know, you look out in my area, we have a lot of Greeks coming over, you know, Polish coming over, who they'll lay tile all day long, and they'll do it for, you know, what Americans are willing to pay for it. But you can't get an American to do the job.
Well, that's
no, because there are alternatives. In America, there are alternatives.
I hire tile setters all day. I hire carpet installers. I've been a carpet installer. You know, so I was a Jewish laborer. And, you know, there's people out there, okay, tile setting is a skill. Carpet installation is a skill. And it's hard work. You put 300 pounds of carpet on your back and you hump it up a flight of stairs. It's not easy.
But when, you know, in America, we do have this whole thing of working your way up.
Yeah, but you teach people these jobs, these skills that give them.
So, hey, Phil, would your kids lay tile?
My kids wouldn't even walk into my store. But
what would they do? Your kids don't do that kind of stuff for jobs because you've worked your way up and you've had your kids work their way up. You know, your dad was at a certain level. You're higher than his level. Your kids are probably going to be higher than your level. And that's the way that it is in America. The same with unions. You know, seniority rules. You know, you're new. You do the grunt work. You get the crap pay. But your kids are going to have a little bit better education, better wages.
The only thing I got against unions is I feel that many of them are corrupt, and at the head of the union, and it's only because
that's where you grew up as a kid was.
Yeah, I saw it.
By the way, we've been joined by Tony. Hello, Tony.
Oh, good evening.
Yeah.
Hey, Renee has her hand up too.
Yes.
I have a statement. For all of you people that think that this is okay, that you go down and pick up a Hispanic person
and pay them cash
at the Home Depot and pay them shit wages to do a cash job, and yes, it's cash, don't you think that if that person was educated and he said, wow, let's see, I have a choice to work inside in an air-conditioned place with at least the same crap-ass money, or work outside in a heated place for shit jobs. The issue is education. If we educate these people, they will get a better job.
Look, hey, Renee, yes. I make damn good money and I work outside.
Well, I don't mean...
And I would rather work outside than work inside.
I don't mean outside, outside. I mean a manual pulse toll digger putting up a fence.
My job is all of the above. I have to bust my ass physical and mental, and that's why I get paid good. So,
you don't have one of those pulse toll diggers that you rent from the hard or from the you rent store?
Hooks on the back of the Jeep.
I have to climb poles all day and carry around a 100-pound ladder all day.
Different from somebody that doesn't have a choice. It's just. It's different.
But the person who doesn't have a choice, that's where my whole point of view is, bring in the people from these other countries to do these lower jobs. And give them legal status so they can put their kids in an okay school. Their kids can get a good education. Once they graduate, maybe some of them will go off to college. Some of them might not go off to college, and they'll get a little bit better of a skilled trade job, and they work their way up the ladder the way it's always been in America.
Well, the thing that gets me about America is traditionally this has been an immigrant nation, and a nation of immigrants.
That's right.
All of a sudden is this a nation of, well, if you're not an American, get the fuck out of here. I mean,
xenophobia.
That's your xenophobia. The thing is, people come to this country. If they come here legally, it's because they want to be here. They want to be part of this country. And they're here to add to the country and to grow themselves. But if people are coming over and they're not, taking their place in line and coming over here with...
What line? There shouldn't be a line.
A sponsor, a job.
There shouldn't be a line.
But there are thousands.
There shouldn't be a
line.
Not
every country has lines to get in.
Because this is a pretty great country.
Yeah, you can't just allow everyone to come here. You have to have some sort of.
If you want to go to Canada,
hold on a second. Okay, Phil, Jason. Jason has his hand up.
The thing that I think is the funniest right now, though, is if you really look at it and you really think hard, the people that you're having a problem with coming over to this country right now are Native Americans.
Really?
They used to own the land.
Hey, you put up this fake. The Europeans put up this fake border between the United States and Mexico. And sorry, you were able to rape all the Indians up here and kill them better, or Native Americans up here and kill them, to make them white. But they're still brown in Mexico, and they used to come up here all the time before the fake border was up, and it's Native Americans that are coming up here taking jobs.
It doesn't matter what happened 150 years.
All right, well, they're Native Americans that are coming over here, and that's what you don't want in this country are Native Americans.
It's not that. You don't want drug dealers. You don't want...
drug dealers. Hold on a second. Phil, what percentage of the people... who are of Mexican descent coming into this country are drug users.
He's watching narcos.
What percentage?
Hey, I'll answer the question, but I have a question. How much drugs come across the border, and how does it get brought across the border? Marijuana, cocaine. How do they get it across the border?
They bring it across the border. Because it's cut out
the wheel well, you can tuck it in here, and then you weld the wheel well back on. That's how you...
What's
the point you're trying to make? I'm asking you, out of all these people that come here, what percentage are drug people?
I would say a lot of them are mules.
And that's why you don't think that Trump's a fucking racist.
Do you really think that people are swallowing drugs and bringing them across the border? Wait a minute, hold on a second, Phil. It's the most inefficient way possible to bring drugs into this country. You don't know what the fuck you're talking about.
Look, you got hundreds of people a day scurrying across the border with a backpack and a gallon of water.
To bring the drugs to who?
They're coming across the border because they want to find work here so they can send money back to their families.
Phil,
how noble
eight ball
is that?
At a time, how much can you bring on you to hide? You know how many tons of drugs come over here? They're not coming over with people.
They can't.
Well, these Mexicans are coming over and their calves look like cantaloupes.
I mean, think about that. Get that kind of drugs on these people.
Yeah, well, you know, that seems to be what's happening. There's, you know, if you look at the borders.
No, that isn't what seems to be happening. That's what Donald Trump has had, the Kool-Aid Donald Trump has had you.
My grandma didn't have any drugs on her when she came over here.
Yeah, exactly.
There is all of these people that have been beheaded and there's bodies.
You're talking about the drug cartel, Phil.
Right.
You're not talking about the average Mexican who comes into this country illegally.
Yeah.
You're talking about the drug cartels, and they don't even come into this country. They're killing all those people on their side of the border.
How do those guys get the drugs over here?
How do they get the drugs over here?
I think you're paying people off to do that.
Yes.
A lot of times it's a semi-truck that has a fake load in the very back end of the semi-truck. So when it gets inspected and they check a couple of boxes, hey, yeah, I see your fruits and vegetables in here. And the whole entire front half of the semi-truck is packed full of pot.
They've got all sorts of things, you know, like
you're living in a mythical world. The fact is, I asked you an easy question. What percentage do you think?
I don't know what the percentage.
Well, then is it 10%? Is it 20%? Is it 1%?
This is not my expertise.
Well, then shut up.
Well, why can't I say that you know, people are coming across the border with drugs?
Don't know that they are.
Probably just as many white people as Mexicans.
Yeah.
Because the white people will go down there and they'll pick up a load and bring it back too.
Any desperate person who needs money, this is how they get it.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
They're coming over. They are desperate. They need money once they get here. And what are they doing?
They wait in front of Home Depot and have people pick them up to do their gardens that day. That's
sure. I'm going to laugh, but he's right about that. They're always on Roosevelt Avenue.
Yeah.
The day laborers, right?
Yeah. It's terrible. They have a problem with.
The problems with the ones that are carrying the drugs over, the ones
and
that
how, what
are
is that,
gang
what is
members.
That percentage, Phil?
I don't know the percentage.
Well, then if you don't know the percentage, you can't make that statement.
Where do the gang members come from?
Just legalize this shit, too, because they're bringing it over for the American customer.
We were this close in California.
They should just legalize pot.
We were this close.
Yeah, just legalize.
All those drug murders on the border.
It's my mayor.
Just simply legalize marijuana. That's 90% of the drugs that are coming across.
Why should they just legalize?
Legalize marijuana everywhere in this country. You will take the bottom out of that whole thing. The murders will stop. The illegal transporting of drugs will stop. Because it's only...
that movie...
NFL plays one.
What happens when they smoke this
Reefer
drug
Madness?
Stuff?
I distributed Reefer
you,
Madness.
You did? Yeah. Oh, the movie, not the
yeah. What movie? Midnight Express?
No, Reefer Madness.
Oh, Reefer Madness?
I was working with the pro marijuana group, we found this movie called Reefer Madness, and it was in public domain, so we made up copies and distributed it to theaters at midnight and made money for normal.
People smoke marijuana.
I gave you plenty of... Yeah, I think I saw that movie 8 times.
Yeah.
We used to go get high in the movie theater and watch it.
Yeah. Well, you know, you should heed the government warning, you know? All of those... Look at those people. They got... You know, they were crazy.
I tell you right now... I just finished a little bit of liquor here.
Yeah.
If pot were legal, I would be sitting here smoking a joint right now.
Yeah, why don't they just legalize it like you said?
Well, you
may get some good ideas.
90% of the drugs coming across the border is marijuana. Uh-huh. And if we legalized it in every state in the union, and we just undercut the market completely.
So, Alex, how much percent of the drugs coming
across the border is marijuana?
What?
It's
about 90%, it's been estimated.
90%. And how is it getting here?
I don't know.
Lots of... They're doing
tons of ways. Believe me, they're not sending it over a person at a time because marijuana is a bulk product. It's always been the most difficult to ship in small quantities. You could do that with cocaine, but you can't do it with pot.
When you say a person at a time, can you imagine going to the airport and pick up Hector? When you said that, they send it over a person at a time. Go to the airport.
And everybody's got to converge in the same place so they can put it all back together with the pounds and pounds of pot.
They're building tunnels under the fences, everything like that, and then getting it through there that way. You know.
These sensors in the ground to
yeah, he's got sensors out in the ground.
So you can see if there's going to be tunnels.
Yeah, well, they've got to go down pretty deep now because those guys are going like 70 feet below the surface.
Oh my God, I can't see Johnny Quest.
And believe me, they're getting more sophisticated at building tunnels than we are.
Damn, man, imagine how if you were to hire some Mexicans to finish that New York water pipeline.
Yeah. Well, maybe Trump will. Yeah, we'll get it done for half the cost.
I think Trump needs the phone numbers of those guys that 707's father hired to build that fence years ago at 25 cents.
Phil, why don't you give up on the dream of Donald Trump ever being president of the United States?
One of my first jobs.
He doesn't listen to me when I talk.
You should give up on the dream of the president of the United States. You've been touting that for a while.
He's not going to be president, Phil. He's just not going to be president. I mean, the bad news is Hillary's going to be, but he's not.
Yeah, you're right about that.
Hey, you know, I visualize, and you know, as long as you visualize, you can make something happen. If it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen. But
something's going to happen. That's
one of my first jobs. Was a minimum wage job. I worked in Jet Hamburgers, and I think I got paid $1.75 or $1.50 an hour. And that was in like 1970.
$1.65 an hour was the country minimum wage then.
The agricultural minimum wage is always less than the regular
by
minimum
far.
Wage.
Absolutely. Because for people working horrid, because they work in shitty, shitty places, and then they have pesticides that they're working with too, and they're not protected.
And some of them were sprayed with pesticides to let them in the country.
Against Monsanto.
We get sprayed with pesticides when we leave certain countries to go to certain other countries, and it's fucking scary to be in an enclosed place with pesticide being sprayed above your head by a flight attendant. There's nothing in it. We just spray the whole plane.
That's
all.
That's not
great.
All I'm saying is that when we talk, you know, what happens is, and I just saw this movie called Our Brand is Crisis. What you do in elections is you create a crisis and then you supply the solution. And exactly. And there has been a phony crisis in this country called immigration. It is not to the extent that everybody thinks it is. The danger of the people coming in are not a great danger. Yes, there are going to be people that are going to come in, they're going to be dangerous, but they could also come in legally as well and still become a rapist or become a drug dealer or whatever. The point is that to castigate an entire group of people based on the actions of a few and not looking at the total picture, that they aren't the only ones coming into this country, and that some of the greatest amount of illegal aliens in this country aren't Mexicans.
No,
they're from other
Polish
parts of the world.
Chinese.
We had a woman here that was cleaning our apartment for years. She finally had to go back to Poland because it turned out that she was here illegally.
Well, you can't run from an office now because you had an undocumented.
I can't run for office because I had.
Oh,
yeah, geez, I told you from.
Did she come over with a visa, or did she just overstay it?
I think
yes, because that is the number one. We don't need a fucking wall. The number one reason of illegal aliens: they came over here illegally and they overstayed their visa.
Absolutely.
Trump wants them to enforce the laws that are here. You know, and that
right, and then you'll be kicking out a whole bunch of Europeans that came over here, and you'll find out that they're the illegal aliens.
We don't care.
Yeah. And then the same color as you, Phil, the same freaking color. So stop talking about.
I'm not a bigot. I don't care what color they are. I don't care if they're Mexican or Black or Irish or, you know, even. Puerto Rican,
And just remember, my ancestors walked over here. How'd yours get here?
By boat.
by boat.
Mic drop.
What? Hey, that's the warning sign across the bow. Rob, are you waving your hand for a reason? Or are you saying goodbye?
Saying goodnight.
Thank you. Jason, always a pleasure. Now. Tell Sabrina to let you out once a week, okay?
Alex is eight right now, and you had a ninth.
Ted, thank you so very much.
Yes, Ted.
Tony, thank you. Renee, nice having you here. Charlene, Phil, everybody. Have a nice Labor Day weekend. Everybody who works for Gabna, take Monday off.
Good night. So kind of you.
we'll see you next week. Bye-bye.
Bye.
That's it for this evening. Stay tuned now for the intersection.
Intersection.
Which comes up next over most of this same station. Wait a minute. Let me, for the TV people, let me give... let me do something here. Yeah, let me also get rid of the people who were calling so that the next show can use the lines, okay? And I guess all I have to say to you out there is, if you see her, tell her I love her, okay? Hey, everybody. Listen, I just want to say goodbye to all the TV people who are watching right now. Nice to have you here, and nice that you joined us. And we'll see you next Friday with another TV version of the Ramble. Okay? Thank you, and good night.